This week on Round Ball Rules, just two games remain to decide the 2023 Grand Final. It's all square between Melbourne City and Sydney FC after their pulsating draw at Allianz Stadium. A game of high-class saves and a second chance from the spot. But can Sydney storm the fortress that is Amy Park? On the other side of the draw, the Mariners, they hold a one-goal edge after taking down the Reds in a Cooper Stadium cracker. It was high intensity for over 100 minutes, and it's left a couple of wounded Reds racing the clock. There is plenty to preview ahead of the second leg of the semi-finals. Cannot wait for them. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Round Ball Rules. I'm Scott Mackinnon, joined by commentator extraordinaire Simon Hill.
Good to see you, Scott.
And championship winner Daniel McBreen. Good to see you, mate.
You too, mate.
All right, before we get into the on-field stuff, what caught your eye off the field? What was your moment of the week, Simon?
Well, the big transfer news involving Jordan Boss of Melbourne City. Of course, it's been rumoured for a while, but it's finally been confirmed that he's heading off to Belgium to join Westerlo, former club of our colleague Alex Brosque, of course, in a $2 million deal, which breaks the Australian transfer record, which was Zeljko Kalac's, $1.7 million all the way back in 1995. It's a great move for the kid. I think he'll make a roaring success of it. He's got talent to burn, and I think he can be the Socceroos' left back for years to come.
I have to 100% agree with that one, Simon. He's been outstanding, and I can see him going all the way to the top. He's got everything you want in a footballer, hasn't he? He's got desire, pace, ability, and I think we'll see him go a long way.
And he scores goals as well and some absolute rippers. How about you? What's caught your eye, mate? Because you're keeping with the youth theme.
I am. The under-23 squad was announced this week and 14 of the players were playing in the A-League, and many of them, pretty much 10 to 11 of them, have been getting constant game time, lots of minutes in the A-League, which is great. And I think this is probably starting to see the fruition of the A-League academies coming to the time now where we're starting to see the first intake going in, and now we're seeing these guys come through. And to see that the majority of those names that we're seeing there are getting good minutes in their respective clubs is, I think, only a positive for this team and for the future of the Australian football.
No Mo Torre, though.
Yeah, a lot of consternation around that one. He's actually gone and got his citizenship at Guinea, and a lot of talk around that and people saying, well, this is a player who's now broken into the first team squad and his team in France, and, you know, maybe a little bit unlucky not to have been called up. Never has been either in any of the age groups.
There you go. Interesting stuff there. I love the fact that these young kids, though, are coming through, and you only have to look at what happened with the Socceroos too, with all those A-League players, and they went very far in Qatar indeed. All right, let's have a look at the games that we saw over the weekend. Some absolutely cracking results there. I mean, Sydney FC, Melbourne City, that is all level, one apiece. Adelaide United with the one goal, Central Coast fought back there to make it 2-1. So they take that into the second leg of the semi-final. Interesting indeed. But let's recap the Sydney FC, Melbourne City one, Simon. Sydney managed to fight their way back again. But who was the real standout? When you were calling the game, who did you get most excited about?
Well, I think it has to be Tom Glover, to be honest. I mean, he made two or three absolutely world-class saves. So won a double stop to deny City a second goal. That was actually given as a goal kick, would you believe?
Yeah.
It should have gone down as a fantastic save. This is just incredible. I mean, I think he actually, his starting position is outside the left-hand post when Robert Mack goes to shoot. And then, of course, he saves the penalty. That's the second penalty saved in two games. And unfortunately, two goals have been the results, which is neither of which has been his fault. Milanovic on the follow-up for the Wanderers round 27. Then, of course, we knew we had the second, the retaken penalty by Sydney for encroachment. So Tom Glover was outstanding. He's another young kid that's, you know, on the up in goalkeeping terms. He's only 24, 25, so he's got a long way to go yet.
Were they hard done by with that encroachment call? What do you think, Macca? Because, I mean, you saw the look on Glover's face there. Yeah, I've done it. And then it's like, oh, God, here we go. And Sydney were able to allow Alfie, Adam Lafondra, to step up and take it.
Well, number one, to the letter of the law, no. But a lot of people saying, well, that's been let go all season. I think because the ball went to Talbot and he was the one that cleared it, it made it a real highlight that we need to act on this. Look, this is another one that I think's really strange, that when a penalty takes one and misses it and they get a retake, I don't think they should be allowed to change.
No, I agree.
Think you've stepped up, okay, you've put your hand up to say you're taking the penalty. It should stay that way. You retake it. That's how it was set the first time. But at this stage, they're allowed to change. I don't think they should, and that's coming from a striker. So
yeah, there you go. Well, it is unfair for the keeper, that is for sure, to mix that up. Let's talk about the other game. It was 2-1 again. It's the third straight win then for the Mariners over Adelaide. But that mouth-watering showdown in the second half between Nestori Iraconda and Jacob Farrell, watching at home, I was on the edge of my seat watching that. How good was that to watch those two young guys going at it so hard?
Yeah, it was unreal. And the interesting thing about it was that when Iraconda was getting ready to come on, straight away Nick Montgomery went and said, Farrell, you're coming on. McGarry had done the attacking job as a defender, gone and scored the goal to get him in front. But this guy is no more for his defending aspects of his game. And you don't see it too much in football when they say he's coming on, you're going on just to do a job. Yeah. And as we said, young guys coming through the system, they were stuck in the last game with each other, but there was a nice moment when they both, after this one here, they both went down injured. They went to the sideline, they were shaking hands to say, good contest, that's what it's all about. And it was wonderful to see.
Now, Maka, there is some talk this week that Adelaide might start Nestori Iraconda in the second leg. Is that a bit of kidology to try and get inside the head of Nick Montgomery so he goes, right, well, I better start with Jacob Farrell?
Yeah, I think it is.
He's never started an A-League game.
He's only played 45 minutes, and I think I'm going to go from memory and say in those 45 minutes when he played 45, he probably wasn't as effective as when he's played 25, 30. So for him to start from the very beginning of the game, I think it might just be a little bit of kidology.
But hang on, they're one goal down, right? So they've got to mix things up and try something different. I mean, this is a bloke who comes on, makes an impact, the crowd lifts.
But what if he comes on and he plays 30 minutes and he's gassed and at half-time, then he's your main impact player and you don't have him at the end.
Fair call. All right. Yeah. What do we make about the mental side of things heading into this, the fact that the Central Coast Mariners have the wood on them? I mean, when you add up the scores, it's 10-2 to the Central Coast over Adelaide. That's got to play on the minds of the Reds players.
I think it does to a certain extent. I think more concern for Carl Viet at the moment is that they're just not in a particularly good moment generally in their season. We've seen when they're at their peak, Adelaide, they could be anybody in this competition. But they've already thrown away, if that's the right word, that home advantage. I think it's going to be very difficult for them. I'm told that over 17,000 tickets have been sold for the game in Gosford.
Yep.
So there's going to be a very partisan, parochial home crowd behind the Mariners. I think it's going to take an almighty performance from the Reds to turn it around. But it's possible.
They're capable, that is for sure. All right, we are off to a quick break. On the other side, we're going to catch up with a couple more championship winners. And I am talking Alex Brosque, of course, from Sydney FC, and Bruce Djite, who got it done for Adelaide United. That's next. Yes, can Sydney FC stop Melbourne City from qualifying for a fourth straight grand final? And who will it be on the other side? Will it be Adelaide United or the Central Coast Mariners? Let's check in with a couple of championship winners, shall we, to find out. And I'm talking about Bruce Djite and Alex Brosque. They've been there, done that. But first, let's catch up with you, Brosky. You've been riding every single moment over the last few weeks, and there's video evidence of that, which is quite entertaining to watch if you can track it down. But what gives you confidence that your boys can make it through to the big dance, the grand final?
Look, I think looking at both of their last two games, you know, the way they went to CommBank Stadium and you know, kept an incredible attack with, you know, Borrello, Leiuni, guys like this, quiet in their home ground. That sort of gives, I guess, them a lot of confidence going into an away clash with Melbourne City, I mean, who have probably the best attack in the competition. And the fact that even at home in that first game, you know, McLaren was, you know, relatively unsighted. We didn't see him have any opportunities. Leckie and Tilio as well were kept fairly quiet as well, I think. Look, I just think Sydney defensively, in terms of shape and structure and the way they're shutting teams down at the moment, you know, it should give them a heap of confidence in being able to do that again.
Now, Broski, in terms of that defensive structure and shape, Luke Bratton has been immense so far. One of the main reasons why Sydney have been successful in this final series so far. Can he back it up a third time?
Look, he's been immense, but I think it's more down to just the fact that, look, he knows what time of year it is. You know, I think it can be long and become a bit of a grind the whole year leading up to the finals. But, you know, experienced players like Luke Bratton, Wilkshire, Grant, Lafondra, all these guys across the park that Sydney have, once they get to semi-final time, they've been there before, they know what these moments require, what you need to be at physically, mentally to be able to, you know, get wins out of these games. So look, for Bratton, it won't be an issue. You know, he's well prepared and done this so many times that he can do it again, and so can all of them.
Nombroski, you sound pretty confident there, mate, with that experience. Do you think are you tipping them to go through?
Absolutely, mate. Look, I think they've got the big game players to do it, and look, that's not taking anything away from Melbourne City. They've been incredibly successful. They've won 3 premierships straight. You know, that achievement in itself is fantastic. But these games require something a little bit different, and I feel like Sydney's got enough players to be able to step up in this moment.
There we go. Thank you, Alex Bross. You'll be doing backflips on Friday night if they can pull that one off. Now, let's get to Bruce Djite in Adelaide for us. Brucey, your boys have got a bit of work to do, but first up, can you give us an injury update on Hiroshi Ibusuki and Nick Ansell? Are they a chance of playing?
Look, I think Ansell is still a chance. Ibusuki, Hiroshi, he's going to be out for a while. He's got a significant calf injury, so something's going to have to change. I don't think it's a particular negative. It's always great to have more options and have all your players fit. But, you know, if you look at the last game, it wasn't working. So maybe it is time for Carl to change something up if he wants to get a different result to the previous 3 he's had throughout the season and the last finals game.
Now, Brucey, there's been plenty of chat this week about the excitement machine, Aaron Kunda, starting. Would you start him?
Well, I think it just changes mindsets, right? Because now the Mariners will have something to worry about, something else to worry about, I should say. As well, it just changes the dynamic of the game from the start. And bearing in mind, we're halfway through, it's 2 legs, so you're halfway through the game technically. Nestori normally comes on in the second half of games anyway. You know, just play from the start. I mean, it's a fine balance. You can't go gung-ho full gas. You've got to have the ascendancy, but you can't go gung-ho full gas because you cop a goal on the counter or something, and like I said, it's pretty much lights out. But it's a tricky spot for the Mariners as well, you know. It's a tricky scoreline 2-1, you know, because if they cop the, you know, whoever concedes the first goal is going to start rocking. It's going to be a bit shaky for them.
Brucey, you don't sound very confident to me. Are you saying that Adelaide can't win?
I think they can. No. They can. They can do it. There's no doubt, and especially in a sport like football, anything can happen. But I also think that they can't just go and do it. You know, they have to be at their absolute best, play out of their skins, and hope the Mariners, you know, have a bit of a dip in form. You know, a few things need to go in the Adelaide United's favour, because they're not just going to rock up and beat Central Coast Mariners 3-0 and easy days. It's going to be a very tough game in a rocking stadium up in Gosford. I mean, the challenge is there. I'm a realist. They can do it, but, you know, I wouldn't be sitting here saying, oh, yeah, no worries, they're going to just walk through this team as they've done in the past, because that hasn't been the case, certainly not this season.
Thank you, Brucey. We know you will be there flying the red flag on Saturday night. Should be an absolute ripper. And, of course, you can catch that game, that juicy semi-final, on 10 Bold and Paramount Plus. Don't miss it.
Look at that from McGarry. Oh, and it's in! Has scored an all-so-precious goal here. Good win it is. And the King of Coopers strikes again.
Well, welcome back to Round Ball Rules, where we are gearing up for two massive semi-finals. It's time now, though, for the commentator's call. And as we found out last week, Simon, it can be a commentator's curse because we spoke about Aidan O'Neill being the big performer. Unfortunately, look, he was out because of soreness. We expect him to be back this week. Yep. But what's going to happen? Yeah, yeah, thanks. What's going to happen over these, well, now it's two legs, the second half, as Bruce was saying, of this one. And it's nil all going into it, really, or one all.
Well, I mean, away goals don't count. So, yeah, it's all square. And I'm leaning still towards Melbourne City for partly historical reasons. You know, the history books show that premiers normally get through to grand finals. Not always, but normally. And they've got the home advantage, Melbourne City. And I think the key for them this week is getting the service to Jamie McLaren. Now, in the first leg of the semi-final, he only had 13 touches of the ball. If we look at his Neds player-level performance stats for this season, of course, they're absolutely astronomical. 24 goals again. Obviously, a few of those are penalties. But you give him chances and more often than not, he will take them. Now, he didn't have opportunities against Sydney FC in the first leg. It's difficult to remember him touching the ball at all in a dangerous area, but he rarely goes two games without getting at least one chance. And because he's so good at converting chances, that's why I think Melbourne City will win. They'll get the ball to him a little bit more in the second leg, particularly at home, and he'll score. I have no doubt.
Tell us about that, Macca, the fact that he can go unsighted and then just pop up and you're like, what? He scored three goals all of a sudden? Yeah. Like, what makes him so special, the areas he gets into?
Yeah, it's his positioning and his anticipation a lot of the times. You know, sometimes if someone's cutting inside, he won't go for the direct route to where will I get it, but he'll anticipate, well, if that guy's going to shoot, the high percentage area for the rebound is here, or I can drift off into an area. He just does it so well. He has this astute just
instinct
that just go, that the ball's going to drop here, and all of a sudden there it is. And when he gets those chances, he puts it away. And like Simon said, he can go in a match 89 minutes and then you'll go, oh, he's playing. And but when you realize he's playing is when he's putting it in the back of the net. He only needs that one chance. So Sydney need to stop that service, as Simon said.
Another one who, well, we didn't see much of is Marco Tilio last week as well. Yep. But I looked at some of the stats. So he scored a brace in two of his last three at Amy Park, and they were some amazing speedy runs that he manages to finish off, just dicing through defenders. How important is a player of his stature to get in and step up and get this team through to a grand final as well?
He's crucial. And you can include Matt Leckie in that conversation as well. And, you know, Andrew Naboot, if he starts on the bench, which he did in the first leg, Valon Berisha can provide, Florent Berenguer can provide. You know, they've got attacking options all over the park. Now, I thought that they paid the price a little bit for having the week off in the first leg. I thought they just looked a little bit undercooked, whereas Sydney, of course, have, you know, haven't been used to playing high-pressure games for a number of weeks now.
Yeah.
But that won't affect them in the second leg. Their record at Amy Park this season is extraordinary. They haven't lost at home all season. One of only three clubs in history to go through the entire campaign without losing a home game. The others being Brisbane Roar under Ange Postecoglou and Sydney FC in season 16-17, I think it was. So, you know, I think it all points towards Melbourne City being the favourites. I'm not writing Sydney FC off because they're in a great run of form at the moment, but I just think City will be too strong.
All right, the other one, Macca. Can the Mariners get through to their first grand final since you guys won it a decade ago? You scored a goal, man of the match. I mean, you keep telling us about this every day.
But what's it's gonna, as bad as Archie Thompson.
Oh, it's incredible, isn't it? But how do you see this one going? What's the crystal ball telling you?
Well, look, they've had the wood on them this year, haven't they, the Mariners? Nick Montgomery's got it right in every game. And Adelaide are a team, look, both teams love to attack and flew up. Adelaide are a team who put balls in the box more than any other team. They have more successful crosses. And when you've got a guy on one, particularly on the left, like Craig Goodwin, who can put those balls in, they're dangerous. But they've got these two guys at the back. There's Nectar Triantis and Brian Kaltak in particular. Now, if these two have got to be in the conversation for me to be the best centre-back pairing apart from Marcelo and Mircella. And this man, Brian Kaltak, this year has been immense. His first year as a professional footballer at 29, how, I do not know. He's physically unbelievable. can play football. 13 clearances last week, six duels he won. He was immense. He covered Jacob Farrell as well when he was having that duel with Aaron Kunda and got across a few times for a few interceptions there as well. This man could be the man that stops them on his own. Yes, they've got plenty of talents everywhere else, but he just, as we talked about Jamie McLaren being in the right place at the right time, defensively, he was... got it right every time last week, and they'll be looking at him to do the same.
And you made the point, Maka, before we came on air about the fact that Nektar Triantis has maybe not got the same headlines as Geordie Boss, Aidan O'Neill, Marco Tilio, one or two others around the league, Keegan Jelicic, as we understand, is off to Belgium as well in the last 24 hours. He could be one of those players who goes and does it over in Europe as
well. Yeah, without a doubt. You look at the stature of the young man, still in a young age, but he's big, he's strong, he's athletic, he's timing tackles as well, strong in the air. Is another one that I look at and I think all things going well and you continue on the trajectory, you're going to have a big career overseas.
Really
and be
good
successful.
Partnership.
Yeah.
Well, it's all to play for. Of course, the winners of this one will go through to the grand final. It's going to be mega. And don't forget the Tobin medal count as well. A big prize handed out on grand final day.
This year's Alex Tobin Medal is brought to you by Isuzu Ute. It's going bigger and better than ever with the winner of the prestigious award receiving $10,000. Plus, the Isuzu Ute Alex Tobin Medalist will nominate a junior football club of choice to win a brand new top-of-the-range Isuzu D-Max or 7-seat MUX. Don't miss the grand final on Saturday, June 3rd, when this year's winner will be revealed.
Do work a lot on their intricate little passes on the edge of the box. Look at that from McGarry. Oh, and it's in! Finding space on the edge of the box has scored an all-so-precious goal here.
Joe Gauchy, he just stands and watches. Nothing he can do about that. A wonderful finish. Take a bow, James McGarry.
Oh, what a goal!
There it is. King James, can we call him that? Is that too much of a stretch? What a goal.
Well, we can't call him Macca.
No, we can't. No. But what a ripper. I mean, easy choice. Or did you prefer Lecky just off that absolute bullet from Berisha?
Well, that was a good goal as well. But yeah, it's more about the delivery from Valon Berisha. And look, Lecky still had to angle his body to turn it into the goal. But that was a terrific finish. And I think James McGarry, and you've made this point throughout the season, when he swapped clubs and Thomas Aquilina went the other way, I was like, that's an interesting move. Can't quite see what the logic is behind there, but boy, he's been good.
He's been fantastic. Yeah. And we can obviously see that's why they brought him in, that go forward, that attitude he has going forward. And it's funny, Adelaide will be spewing with that because before the game, it was pointed out that that's the space that had been killing them. And yeah, I spoke to their coaching staff before the game and they were like, yep, we need to kill that space. He got that space, but he gave everyone, I thought, they must have thought he was going, because I did and we all did, and I think Joe Goucher did, all thought it was going to this way, and he just bent at that side, and it was a wonderful finish, fantastic goal.
You can see Goucher,
what a way to get yourself back in the league.
Yeah, and who teed it up, hey? Was it Kaltak, wasn't it?
Was it Kaltak?
Yeah, I think he passed that ball through for him, he's a man of
many. He's got assists in
him. He's got it all. What can't this man do?
Just don't talk about the red cards.
Yeah,
a few of them. Or maybe the handball at the start of the game as well, but what a way to bounce back from that as well. Oh, what a cracking game it was from him. All right, massive games coming your way. These two to decide the grand final for this year. Melbourne City up against Sydney FC, Friday, 7 p.m. Make sure you tune in on 10 Bold and Paramount Plus. That will be juicy. Of course, Lecky scored in the first one. And the second one, Saturday night, 7 p.m. again, 10 Bold, Paramount Plus. It is the Mariners up against Adelaide United, and it's going to be in Gosford. Simon, I think your T-shirt says it all. Football without fans is nothing, and there's going to be plenty there on the Central Coast. That'll be a great vibe. I looked at the weather. It's going to be bang on. It'll be a ripper.
It'll be terrific, and let's hope they go close to breaking the attendance record, which I think is 19,238 from back in
2008,
year one or two.
There you
anyway,
go.
It's early on in the A-League era, and that'll be a great atmosphere on Saturday night.
We want this place to be packing and rocking. All right, that is all we have time for. Thank you for your company.
Cheers,
guys. Thanks for watching at home, and yes, we'll be talking about the grand finalists next time. Have a great weekend watching the footy.